Hello friends, thanks for joining me in today's lecture. From today onwards, I am starting Terraform series. Terraform is a tool for building, changing, versioning infrastructure in an effective way. This sounds like an infrastructure as a code solution. When I say infrastructure as a code solution, let's take a look back at 10-15 years back. We used to deploy our application, and whenever there is a demand to deploy your application on production, you has to provision your infrastructure manually or maybe by some other means. But when infrastructure as a code came into picture, it was pretty much easy. So what infrastructure as a code does? Basically, you write some code to manage your, to provision some servers, or in basically in terms, if I say if you want to deploy any application, so by writing some script, you ask that resources to get created. So what is the advantage of Terraform? The Terraform advantage is it's a reproducible environment. It's a easing collaboration, self-service infrastructure, supported infrastructure. When I say reproducible environment, it means, let's say you have a production environment, you want to provision some more environments for temporary basis, for example, stage, for example, some other environment like UAT, some dev environment and QA environment. With the help of infrastructure as a code, you can easily do that. It's not only limited to the Terraform, but if any infrastructure as a code you are using, you can easily provision the copy of the production server in just a few statements. Easy collaboration, having all the infrastructure as a code, all the code for the infrastructure at one place like GitHub, Bitbucket, or any repository sharing system, it is easy to collaborate with other developers, so they can just easily come and they can change or they can add their requirement over there. The third point is self-service infrastructure. In earlier days, we used to depend upon the person who were in charge, to provision the infrastructure for us. For example, as a developer, we want to deploy our application to the production server. We used to come to the person who's handling all the infrastructure for us. We send them the request to get the server created for us. And after that, this process has been completed, we used to deploy our application to the servers. But now those things has been reduced. The dependency has been reduced now. The self-service infrastructure, you can write your own code. You can just get the infrastructure created as your demand. And if it is not in you, you can easily dispose it. Terraform is not limited to the only one cloud supported. It's like AWS. It has a mini support for many cloud platforms like Google, Azure, AWS, etc. Terraform, we have other infrastructure code option for with each cloud platform. For example, Amazon Web Services has CloudFormation to provision their resources with some, but they have their different configuration to write the syntax, that they have different way of doing it. Similarly, Microsoft Azure has Azure Resource Manager templates, and Google Cloud Platform has Deployment Manager. When to use the Terraform? As I said, when you want something on disposable basis, or you want to have a multiple copies of a similar environment, you should go with the infrastructure as a code. A structure configuration language that is both human and machine friendly for use with command inline tools, but specifically targeted towards tools and servers. What it means is, this kind of a language is specifically meant for provisioning the servers to use with the command line tools and etc. So you can read more about configuration language looks like. But in my opinion, a Terraform configuration is a complete document in the Terraform language that tells Terraform how to manage a given collection of infrastructure. So let's start with Terraform in details. In Terraform, we have certain terms we have to understand first before jumping on to the lab session. So in Terraform, generally you have heard of provider. Provider is basically a plugin and integration that is responsible for API integration for underlying infrastructure. So when you, let's take an example of AWS. and you say, hey, I want to provision, I want to create some S3 bucket, and there's a certain parameters or that there's certain requirements while you're creating the S3 buckets. So providers come into the picture, which has all the API related information, which will interact to the AWS basically, and it will convert your SCL language, basically your human readable language, into the form of API, and it will send to the AWS. So AWS can understand your information in machine form. Basically, the provider is used in Terraform to perform CRUD operation. As I said, you can dispose the infrastructure, you can change the infrastructure, you can have a version about your infrastructure. So all the CRUD related information you can perform with the help of provider. As I mentioned earlier, it is a plugin which has all the instruction to deal with the infrastructure, for example AWS, GCP, Azure and etc. So Terraform itself has a registry, or basically a marketplace, where they keep adding all the providers they have support for. So you can find all those details, all the available providers at given link. I'll add this link into the description section as well and upload this PPT to the video. So you can find the relevant provider there. You can utilize it. We will see how to use that plugin or provider in our lab session. But if you want to learn more about it, how the provider looks like, you can go and you can browse more about it. Resources. This is the most important element of the configuration of Terraform configuration. Resource block describe one or more infrastructure object, such as compute, instance, virtual network, or high-level components. When I say resource, is basically in terms of infrastructure, it is an object. For example, if you want to provision some S3 bucket, or if you want to provision some EC2 instances, so here resource will represent to that S3 bucket, or here resource will represent to that EC2 instance. Similarly, in other cloud engineer, in the other cloud platform, you can also use the same set of code to provision the resources. How does this resource block basically can be written in our SCL language basically? So there's a certain syntax you have to follow. The first part of the syntax, resource, is a keyword that will tell Terraform provider basically you want some kind of an operation on particular object. The second one, which is highlighted into pink color, is the method exposed by your provider. If I'm using AWS provider, so this is the method, or basically you can say this is the API exposed by that provider, which will have the interaction with your request to the AWS. The third one is the identifier, how you want to identify your resources. You can name as per your choice, but it should have a valid identifier. For demonstration purpose, I have said it like web. So what we have learned in this chapter, the resource is used to create the object, manage the object in cloud platform, and it relates to the object or the services in the cloud platform. As you know, this is a kind of a programming language, then it will have some kind of a data type, some container to hold the value and all that stuff. So what is data type basically? It is a information to the container what values is going to be stored, or what kind of a values is going to store into that container basically. When we say container, it's like variable. So inside this Terraform, we have these kind of a data type available: string, number, boolean as a primitive one, list, object, map, tuple as a collection one. So you can use the combination to create a complex data type to deal with your requirement or deal with your situation. But here in this string, there's one point to note about it. In Terraform, you have to use the double quotation. You cannot use single quotation for a string representation. As like other programming languages, we have also variable section here, but in this Terraform, we have three types of variables: input variable, output variable, and the local variable. If I try to relate this variable into the traditional programming language, then input variable is just an argument to a function. When you write some function, you expect some argument, it is input variable. It means to execute some set of information or some set of instruction, you are expecting some arguments. Input variable section is basically can be used to provide the dynamic information or dynamic values to particular Terraform configuration or Terraform instruction. The syntax for variable section is almost same as resource block, but as you know, resource block does depend upon the API exposed by the plugin or provider. Unlike that provider, variable section, unlike that resource block, variable section does not depend upon any method exposed by providers or plugin. So here we have two parts. First is the keyword named as variable. The another one is the identifier name, which you can use as per your, you know, requirement, as per your choice. But this set of block, when we say block, the curly braces opening and the ending of curly braces has few parameters defined. The first parameter is type, which will tell what kind of a variable, what data type of variable is that we have seen into the previous slide. The description is more friendly message, which will let anybody knows about this variable. So you can put any friendly message if you want. So you can put all those details here. Default is something if you want to make your variable required or optional. Having default parameter set, it will not be asked during the execution. Sensitive, expect a boolean flag, which tells Terraform whether to show this information on window, on command line, on cloud to the user, or it should be hidden completely. Having it true, it means that information is sensitive to the user, so it will be hidden. By default, its value is always false. Since 0.13 version, there is an additional set of block which is called validation. If you want to have some kind of a validation on your variable, then you can use this validation block, which expect two parameter condition. That condition could be an expression, interpolation, or use of any function that we will see into the lab basically. And the second parameter is error message you want to throw. How we can access this variable? For example, you have defined this variable into the file and you want to access somewhere within the your project, then you can access using var dot the name of variable. The second set, the second type of variable is output variable. If I try to use it into the traditional programming language, it is a return value from a function. It is very similar to the variable one. The only difference is keyword and some blocks are missing from here. So output is something if you want some information from your set of execution or from your resources, you can use output to get the value basically. So how you can write the output? You have to write the output keyword, then the name of, you know, particular that out variable. And inside that block, we have a three parameter, basically value, description, and the sensitive. As you know, sensitive is just used to make the things hidden during the execution. Description is for friendly purposes, friendly messages purposes. And value, here you can access any resources to get the information about that resources. And how we can do that, we will see it into the lab section. And access the output into the different file, you can just call it as an instance name, the name of your, basically with the help of your identifier. The third one is basically it has meaningful importance, because when you have some static data or you have some kind of a sort of calculation and you don't want to rely on some dynamic value, probably that is part of input variable, then you can store those information as a temporary variable called local variable. And that temporary local variable is scoped to a function in the traditional programming language. And the syntax for is very much similar. You have to write the locals, opening and closing braces, and then you have to have key and value. And value could be anything like string, boolean, number, any data type you want, or it could be the interpolation or the expression and the result from the expression itself. The first on the left hand side, from if you look at the equal sign and the left hand side is the key. And how you can access this locals in other file using locals.instance name. You can have the multiple things, instance name, instance ID and everything. But these should not be the comma separated. Each line is treated as a different set of locals. So if I want to run the, if I want to add more key to it, I have to have a new line and I will add the new key and respective value for it. That is all for this lecture. We'll see you in the next lecture. Thank you very much.